Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to look at allylic halogenation. So this is a substitution reaction. We're substituting out a H for a halogen. If we're going to add chlorine, we can just use Cl2 as a reagent. And this is done either in a photochemical way, so using light energy, or we can heat it. So this is the symbol for heat, this little triangle here. So let's go to the next slide and we'll draw the mechanism for this reaction. This reaction proceeds through a radical mechanism, and it begins with the homolytic bond cleavage of the Cl2 group. So light energy or heat energy is going to cleave this bond such that each chlorine gets one electron. So I'm using single-headed arrows because I'm moving one electron at a time, and that will give me two chlorine radicals over here. And we call this the initiation step because it sort of gets the whole reaction going. Now we have radical intermediates and they can react with our molecule of interest. So we have this alkene here and we're going to react that with one of those chlorine radicals. And it's going to pull a proton off of the allylic position. So the position next door to the double bond. This is the most stable radical intermediate that can be formed because it's going to be resonance stabilized. So when we do mechanistic work with radicals, we often do what I call meet in the middle arrows to show things. So the electron on my chlorine is going to abstract the hydrogen atom. So I'll have an arrow starting from that CH bond and sort of ending and meeting right there. That indicates that HCl is being made. There's still one more electron in that bond, and that's going to go onto the carbon. So that will give me my radical intermediate here. And then HCl as a byproduct. This radical intermediate has resonance structure, so because that pi bond is next door, you have a resonance structure, but they're equivalent to one another. So this molecule has an element of symmetry around it. So I can draw those two contributors and they contribute to the stability of the overall radical intermediate. But in terms of what my product looks like, it's going to be the same because I'll just have a five-membered ring with a double bond and then a chlorine adjacent to that. So then at any given time in solution, I only have a small amount of chlorine radicals. So some of those bonds will have been cleaved homolytically, but most of them are not. Radicals are very reactive, and so they don't exist for long periods of time. And the majority of the Cl2 in solution is going to be in the form of Cl2. So statistically speaking, the chances of two radicals coming in contact with one another is very small. So my radical intermediate that I've formed is much more likely to run into a Cl2, and that's how it will get its chlorine. So again, I did those meet in the middle arrows to show the formation of the carbon-chlorine bond, and then I have a Cl radical that will be formed, and that will go on to propagate my reaction further. So I have this double bond here and the chlorine. So now I've formally done my substitution reaction. It's upside down from what I started with, but if I flipped it 180 degrees up, it would be the exact same orientation as that original H, and I would name it the same thing. So that's a good clue that it is the same molecule. If you named it systematically, it doesn't matter if it's upside down or backwards, same molecule. And then, like I said, you get another chlorine radical, and this can go on and propagate further. So this chlorine radical that I just generated can go and react with another equivalent of alkene and just keep this reaction going until all of the alkene has been consumed. So we can accomplish the same type of transformation with bromine. So we can substitute a hydrogen for a bromine, but instead of using Br2, we use a reagent called NBS or N-bromosuccinamide, and that's this molecule right here. So NBS just provides a low concentration of bromine in solution, and that's important because bromine can add across a double bond as well as adding a Br to the allylic position. So if we keep the concentration of bromine low, we get allylic halogenation in our desired product, and we don't have to worry about Br2 adding across a double bond and creating that product, that dibromide that I just X'd out. This isn't so much a concern with chlorination because chlorine is smaller and it doesn't add across the double bond as readily as bromine because of the intermediate that that reaction proceeds through. But when you see bromination at the allylic position, you're often going to see NBS as a reagent. So I want to address one last thing as we cover allylic halogenation, and that is the presence of asymmetrical radical intermediates. So if you have two unique resonance contributors, then you're going to get multiple products. So I've given a starting material here that generates two possible products. And so we'll go through the mechanism on the next page so that we can see how that happens and how we can predict what products we'll see given the structure of our starting material and the subsequent radical intermediate. So I'm starting out with my initiation step here. There's a low concentration of Br2 in solution from my NBS. It is going to be homolytically cleaved, that bond between the two bromines, by, in this case, I wrote heat energy, but you could also use light energy. And that gives me my bromine radical for my initiation step. So now I'm going to draw my H at an allylic position here. I've got this bromine radical in solution, and it can bump into some alkene. And again, I'm going to do these meet in the middle arrows. So that says that HBr is forming, and that would generate an allylic radical. And so now I would have this radical plus I made HBr. And that radical has another resonance contributor that is not symmetrical, like on our last example, to the first one. And so because I have two radical contributors, I can make two products. And the more radical contributors you have that are unique, the more products you can make. So in this case, I'm just going to draw the abstraction of the bromine to make that final product with my lower radical intermediate. So I'm going to have these meet in the middle arrows. So there's one coming from here to there, showing that I'm making my CBr bond. There's one electron left in that bond, and that will generate more bromine radical that can then go and propagate further. So you can see that's the mechanism for making that product. And then we can go to the next slide and show how I would make the other product. So I've redrawn my original resonance contributor that was generated when the hydrogen atom was abstracted from the allylic position. This, of course, could also bump into a Br2. Radicals are very reactive. They would react very quickly upon bumping into a Br2, and that would give me this product here plus another bromine radical that's going to go and propagate. So when you have unique resonance contributors, you can get a mixture of products. So you want to make sure that you draw all valid resonance contributors so you can predict what products you'll see. This has been a look at allylic halogenation, specifically chlorination and bromination using NBS, and how resonance contributors can impact the number of products that are observed. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends. Thanks.